Hey everybody, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I am so glad you decided to join us today. My name is Zach Moore and this is my wife, Rachel. I serve on the worship team and also with vertical worship. And again, we are just so glad that you decided to join us online.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm pumped to be here as online host for this weekend.
Golly,
and
what an honor.
One thing we'd love to know is where everyone is watching from. So let us know in the chat or in the comments what city you're from, what state you're watching from. It's just really cool to see where Harvest Online is.
It really is.
Another thing I'm super excited about this weekend is we get to hear from Pastor Eddie Hoagland.
Gosh, love it.
I love when he preaches. His heart is so strong for God's word. And we're continuing our Romans series called The Road to Reality.
That's right.
And we're gonna be looking at Romans 12, 14 through 21 today. It's a very practical passage, and I'm just really excited to see how God uses this message in everyone's lives this weekend.
Absolutely. Hey, one of the things we want to know is how we can pray for you. And one of the pillars of Harvest Bible Chapel is believing firmly in the power of prayer. And we would love to know how we can pray for you today. And you can let us know that in three ways. So the first way is you can post your request in the chat or the comments. The second way is you can click on live prayer on the website or the prayer link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook. And lastly, you can submit a prayer request on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So if you have this app, you can scroll down here to prayer request and you can punch that prayer request in for us right there. And I'm telling you right now, we count it a privilege to pray with you this week. So, at this point, we're ready to dive right into
Let's
our service.
It.
So
yeah.
we welcome you to join us as we worship the Lord in spirit and truth.
Well, good morning, Harvest, and it's great to be leading you in worship this morning, wherever you are. We are reaching out to your homes this morning and just inviting you to engage the Lord with us. Before we do that, I just want to welcome a couple on our church who have just come on staff. To my right, your left, this is Vanessa. And Vanessa and our husband, who is Tim, right over there on the other side of the stage, are worship leaders. They've been longtime friends of ours within the church, and now they have made their way all the way over from Bend, Oregon, to be on staff with us here at Harvest. Guys, we're so glad that you're finally here, and we're looking forward to a fruitful season ahead. You'll be seeing them across our campuses in the next few months to come. So let's stand up wherever we are and let's lean in. Come on, let's engage the Lord together as we lift up our praises to Him. His grace is enough. It's on our side. Come on.
Our way, God, we lift it high. Your love will never fail. believe that. Come on, sing. From glory to glory in Jesus' name. From mourning to dancing in Jesus' name. From battle to blessing, we go in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We've seen your faithfulness in the darkest night. We've seen your goodness, God. Favor on our lives everywhere we go. Your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side. Whatever comes our way, God be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify everywhere we go. Your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side.
Well, as we continue in worship, I want to welcome you to our online service. My name is Rachel Moore, and this is my husband, Zach, who serves on staff here at Harvest. And we both get the privilege of serving in our worship ministry here. And we're just so glad that you're joining us today. If this is your first time joining online, I especially want to welcome you. We're just so excited that you are watching today.
That's right. And whether you're new or if you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. And you can do that on this page, through a link in the comments, or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know you're here today and how we can pray for you this week.
Absolutely. And you know, before we get too far away from Thanksgiving, we wanted to let you know how we saw God use Harvest to provide meals and food for so many people who needed a little extra this year. So together across four of our campuses, we saw God do this. We provided 475 meals, which fed more than 1,200 individuals.
That's crazy.
And we had 235 people volunteer to help pack and deliver those meals. And the bonus of all of this was that six people accepted Christ as their Savior through the distribution of these meals.
Incredible.
So we just want to say thank you for everyone who gave, served, and prayed for this event.
That's right, I love it. Hey, so I love Christmas, and we want you to plan to spend this Christmas with Harvest. On Sundays, December 20th and 27th, our worship ministry has planned special worship services to focus our hearts and minds on the birth of Jesus. This will be for our online and in-person services on each of the Harvest campuses. And our Christmas Eve service will be extra special this year. It will be available on demand, online, all day on Thursday, December 24th. Whenever you get together with family or friends that day, you can watch the service together online. There will be no in-person Christmas Eve services this year, but you will not want to miss this amazing online service on December 24th. For all the details, go to harvestnow.info.
Absolutely, and I'm really excited to get to watch that on Christmas Eve.
It's gonna be amazing.
And another thing that I'm super excited about, and I really can't believe that I get to announce this, is that we want to invite you to join us on Friday, December 18th from 4:15 to 10 p.m. for Harvest's first ever outdoor Christmas event. And we're calling this event Come and See a Christmas Experience in Lights. It's gonna be a drive-through event at our Elgin campus, and it's just gonna be sharing Christmas through the gospel. And you can tailgate, meet church staff and friends, and there will also be a small Christmas market, live nativity, live reindeer, and a beautiful winter wall.
Wow.
We're just really, really excited. And like the best part about this is that the event is totally free.
Oh my goodness.
But space will be limited, so we need everyone to register. Registration opens on today at noon Central Time.
That's
so
right.
Invite your neighbors, bring your family, come with your small group, plan to fill, because we don't want you to come alone.
No,
so
no.
Plan to fill your car, truck, or SUV, and join us. It's gonna be super awesome. I'm really excited.
That's right.
And you can get more details at harvestnow.info.
Harvestnow.info.
Everything
it's
you
the
need.
Place to be. Hey, so we know that God loves a cheerful giver, and as we approach the end of 2020, we invite you to give cheerfully and generously.
Yeah.
The Lord has given so abundantly to us, and we're inviting you to give to His work in this church. And He's just like asking, I mean, He's asking us to be obedient
Absolutely.
To Him by giving. And so you can give online on the Harvest app through a text or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus.
Yeah.
I invite you to do that now. So as we continue in this service, will you join me as we pray for our giving and the rest of our service today? Father, we love you so much, and we're so grateful to be able to come before you to worship you, Lord. In spirit and truth, Lord. Would you just be with our service today? Would you be with Eddie as he brings the word?
Yes.
We love you so much, Lord. In your name I pray, amen.
Amen.
So as we continue in worship, let's lift our voices to the Lord.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. I will make room.
Scripture says that as far as the heavens are above the earth, that his ways are higher than ours, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Lauren, I love that song so much. I love the idea of bringing the message of making space, making room for the Lord. It brings so much conviction to my heart because I've noticed in my life this year that I've been filling my mind, filling my time with anything that I can get my hands on to make this abnormal year seem normal. Whatever false comfort that's providing, I've just been grasping at it. Everything is backwards. Everything is sort of upside down. We're living in a world that we didn't plan for, we didn't expect. It's very unconventional, and that can be very difficult for us. It's been difficult for me. But I'm being reminded very, very often that God works in the unconventional. He's constantly tearing down the idols that I've erected of grasping for things, false comforts. He's constantly shaking up the traditions and rituals and religiosity that we cling so tightly to. He's replacing it with something far better. So why is that so hard for us? Why is that so difficult for us? It's because it's outside of what we've planned for. It's outside of what we can control. The people of God expected a king. They got a baby. They expected royalty. They got humility. They expected a ruler. They got a sacrifice. Jesus was everything promised, everything prophesied, but in a very unexpected, perfect, and holy way. That's the gospel. When we were separated, God made a way through his Son. When we were cut off from an inheritance, he grafted us in and calls us sons and daughters, giving us a royal priesthood. When we were lost in utter darkness because of our depravity, through his loving kindness and mercy, he has led us to repentance. When we incurred a debt that was far too great for us to pay because of our sinfulness, he paid it, giving us a free gift of eternal life, a hope, an eternal glory. This is something that we cannot work for, that we cannot earn. It's free. So as we make space, as we prepare him room, amidst all of the schedules in this Christmas season, the celebrating with family and friends, the busy, let's let this be the prayer of our hearts. Would you pray this with me now? Lord, this month, this season, shake up the ground of all my tradition. Break down the walls of all my religion. Help me to see that the ways that you're working in my life, in the life of my family, in the life of my church, that your way is so much better than my own. Help me to receive your gospel afresh, to see it with the eyes of a child, to hear it with the heart that is open and ready. Thank you for your ways. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you for Jesus. In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise.
rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born.
Sing this out.
Great is the Lord God Almighty. He's worthy of honor and praise. And I stand in awe of his glory. And I stand in need of his grace. Hallelujah. Yeah.
God, no matter where we're at today, we give you honor. We give you praise in our homes, wherever we're watching this, God. Our hearts well up with worship for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God, you're reigning and ruling, and we're trusting in you. We love you, Lord Jesus. And God, we just give you this service today. We give you this moment for your spirit to do whatever you want to do. We make room for you right now. Come on, let's sing that out one more time. For the Lord our God Almighty reigns. For the Lord our God Almighty reigns. For the Lord our God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, hey, everybody. It is good to see you. I had to turn my microphone on there, right? Hopefully that helps you hear me better. But hey, it's good to see you. I am glad that you are joining us. Welcome to Harvest Online. And well, I guess I can't see you, right? I haven't gotten to see you in person for a while. And if that's you, if you've had to stay online this whole time, can I just say I miss seeing you. I miss seeing you in person. And I'm excited about the day we can see each other again in person. But thankful for the technology that allows us to be together in this way until we can be together in person. And I wanted to let you know that our teams have been tirelessly working on finding different ways for us to minister to one another. And I'm excited to announce that actually starting next week, we're going to be moving away from pre-recorded services. So yes, what you're watching right now was recorded prior to today in order for you to be able to watch it. But starting next week, you're going to be watching the live service. So that means you're going to get to see people worshiping with you online. You're also going to get to see people in the room as I'm preaching next weekend. So very thankful for the tireless efforts of our teams that they've been putting a lot of work in, because there was no playbook for 2020, okay? We've had to figure out a lot of things this year, and I'm so thankful for our teams that have been working hard. And here's the heart behind it. Here's why we're changing this. We want to be more together. And this is going to put us more together than we've been since March, because we're all going to be watching the exact same service, whether online or in person. So looking forward to that next week. Hey, times are changing, right? This is just, it's just part of life right now. You got to be pretty okay with change. And if you're not okay with change, 2020 is probably your least favorite year of all time. There's so much change going around, but not only change in the sense that we've experienced this year, but things just change over time. This is normal, right? Kids are different than what it was, you know, 10, 20 years ago. I remember I noticed a difference when my 3 or 4 year old walked up to my phone, you know, picked it up, and they're like, click, 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 and like unlock my phone. And I'm looking at my child, I'm like, yeah, I'm not okay with that. I'm not okay with the fact that you knew that the phone needed to be unlocked, and then I'm especially not okay with the fact that you knew my passcode. Like, we're raising these little hackers, you know, like from the ages of 2 or 3, they already know how to work with these devices, but they're used to it. They're growing up in a world with media, and who would have ever thought that I don't even have cable? Like, I actually never quite had cable. We had cable for a couple years because it was included with our rent. And then once we moved out of that place, we were like, yeah, we don't need it. We'll just stream stuff. And that's because things are changing. But here's something else that's changing. I can tell that things are a bit tense right now. Can you sense that? Can you sense how, you know, everyone's just a little bit on edge with all the change that's been going on and all the disagreement and all the division? And so that puts everyone on edge. So there's a bit of tension in our culture, but not only that, but the tension between what it means to be a Christian and what it means to be a Christian today in America in 2020, that tension is rising. And it's not quite like what it used to be. And so the question of how do we respond to the external environment that we live in has really come to the forefront of our conversations. But let me just start by saying this. Hey, it's going to be okay. And here's why I know it's going to be okay is because King Jesus is coming back, okay? He is coming back. We're about to celebrate Christmas. That's when he first came. But he's coming back again. There's another Christmas that's still to come, another Advent. And the prophet Isaiah said that when he comes, the government will be upon his shoulders. Man, I'm excited about that day, okay? No elections, no re-elections, because there's just one king, and all will see and acknowledge him as king. And he will rule and he will reign perfectly. But what do we do until that day? Well, Romans chapter 12 speaks directly to that topic. This passage was written to a group of believers in Rome who were experiencing tension between them and the society that they lived in. And so here Paul is giving them instruction on how to respond to that society that they lived in. Now let's go back to the start of the chapter. I'm going to be preaching from verse 14 to the end, but at the beginning of the chapter, you might remember that Romans 12:1 is where Paul says that we are to present our bodies as a living sacrifice. And that term might be a little weird to think of, right? Living sacrifice, what does that mean? Well, think of it as sacrifice as in being dead to your way, but living in the sense that you are alive to God's way. That's how we can be a living sacrifice. We're saying, God, not our way, but your way. So get ready for some pretty radical stuff that's here in Romans chapter 12. So I'm just giving you a heads up, all right? There's going to be some things that you might listen to, and you're going to get to like feel like, Eddie, I'm not sure I can get there. So that's what I just want to tell you. Remember, we're a living sacrifice. So we're dead to our way. And if God says it, we want to believe it, because here's what I've seen time and time again. God's way is always better. It's always better. And get this, it always leads to greater joy for you. So no matter what we're hearing today, even if it's hard to hear, know that God's way is always better and it leads to greater joy for you. So today we're talking about the Christian response to a broken world. The Christian response to a broken world in Romans chapter 12. You know, we call this series The Road to Reality because there is so much that God has given to us when we became his children. And we call it The Road to Reality because there's this whole reality that God created for you that you might not even know exists. And as a believer, you get to start discovering that reality, like the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and then acknowledging God's sovereignty, all the things that we've been talking about. And Romans is just such a great book to help you find that reality, the road to that reality. And today we're going to be talking about what is the reality as far as our response to a broken world. So much of what we teach from a pulpit has to do with things inside of us, right? And what I love about this passage is that it teaches us what to do in the environment and society that God has placed us in. So let's pray, and then we'll jump in. Father, I'm just asking that you would speak with clarity through this passage to us. We're ready to listen. Holy Spirit, we invite you to really make this passage jump out at us and that we would respond with our yes to you, Lord. We want to obey the things that you have said because we love you and because you loved us first, God. We're just responding with this love towards you. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. All right, the Christian response to a broken world. Our first point, starting in verse 14 of Romans chapter 12, is that we are to speak blessing generously. We're to speak blessing generously. What does verse 14 say? It says, "Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them." So right off the bat, this one's like, what? What? Bless those who persecute you? Well, what does that mean? Okay, so those who persecute you refers to people who are out to get you. It's not just people who are out to kill you, though it definitely means that, but it's anyone who's out to get you. It's not just someone who did one thing that was wrong towards you. We're not talking about a single offense. We're talking about someone who's chasing you. Okay, that's how it has to feel, that they're chasing you, they're after you, and they're not leaving you alone. It kind of reminded me of a time when I was, I don't know, somewhere around fourth grade, and we were visiting a Christian school just for the day, because I was actually homeschooled all elementary school, right? Homeschoolers, homeschool high five. Yeah, yes, all the homeschoolers out there. I loved it. My mom was a great teacher, but I was a homeschooler all throughout elementary school. And so we just visited this school for a day, and so I could kind of get a sense of what it would be like to be in a classroom with more than, you know, just my siblings. So we're there, and we get to recess, and there was this one kid who was, I don't know, I'd describe him as clingy, maybe, might be the right word, where he just had to be around me for some reason. And then what proceeded to happen was kind of like what happens in those movies where, like, someone's walking down the street calmly and they kind of look behind them, and then there's someone what they think is following them. Then they kind of pick up the pace a little bit, and then that person picks up the pace, and they start a little jog, and then the person starts jogging. They're like, all right, this is a chase. So then they just start sprinting. That's what happened to me at that recess, okay? I start looking at this kid, and I'm like, all right, monkey bars, he's right behind me. Slide. Right behind me. So then I just start like running all throughout the playground trying to lose this guy. And I'm like, you know, huffing and puffing because I'd been running around all through this playground. And I just have to take a break. So he catches up to me and he comes up to me and he's like, oh, who are we running away from? And I was like, we're running away from you. Like, you are the person that is chasing me. And I didn't enjoy it. You know, I just had to be a little honest with him at that point. And that's just a kid's story, but that was my example. I remember that feeling of, man, this guy's just chasing me, and I don't like it. And God says, bless that person. Bless that person. To bless means to ask God special favor or that he would be gracious towards that person. Then notice he says, bless them and do not curse them. Why does he add that phrase? Well, he's bringing attention to what he's actually saying we should do. Because he could have only said, do not curse those who persecute you. He could have just said that sentence. But he's clear that our calling, the calling we have as believers, is to bless those who are out to get us. And let me talk a little bit about that word bless, because it's not really a word we use commonly. It's one of those words, you know, in conversation when like someone says like, we're just blessed. And you're like, oh, they might be Christian, right? Like it's one of those trigger words because we don't really use that in our culture too often. So let me just talk about how do I bless someone? What does that mean? Two simple things. Blessing someone means that you pray for God to be gracious to them. So we could actually translate the word blessing in this passage as the word pray, because you're going to ask God for things on their behalf. Pray to God that he would be gracious to them, that he would give them things that they don't deserve. And then secondly, it could also just mean speaking words to express good desires over their lives. It's like when you bless someone in person, you say, this is what I want for your life, and I'm blessing you by saying those good desires over your life. He says, you bless them and don't curse them. So when he says curse, that means don't pray, you know, calamity or disaster upon their lives. And as soon as I studied that, I started thinking, well, hold on a second. I feel like I've read some Psalms where David's pretty like, you know, God, go get my enemies, you know, like give them what they deserve. And at first it kind of seemed like the same thing as cursing, but they really aren't the same thing. It's a both and situation. I would say when David's praying in the imprecatory Psalms, he's not praying evil upon his enemies. He's praying for justice. And that's not the same thing as evil. Justice is a good thing. It's something that God can bring against his enemies. So he's praying for justice and not for evil for someone. So in the same way, it's both and. You can pray for God to bring justice to those who are enemies of God, and you can also do that and pray blessing over those enemies. Those aren't in conflict. You can do both those things. See, some of you who sense that you're being chased, you've settled for just not fighting back, thinking that's the Christian response to a broken world. You know, here's someone who's out to get me, they desire to harm me, and I'm just not gonna fight back. I'm not gonna do anything. But my question to you is, are you blessing them? Because that's the high calling you have on your life as a Christian. Are you blessing them? And if it's someone that you think about every day because they're chasing you and they come up every day in your mind and in your heart, I would say that's a sign that you should be praying for them and blessing them every day. Bless those who persecute you. We are to speak blessing generously. Then this, we are to experience empathy with all people. Let's read verse 15. He says, Paul says, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Now, we can't quite catch this in the English language, but Paul is kind of going out of his way to use tenses to show that he's softening up the phrase a bit. Because in English, it just reads very plainly, right? Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. In the original language, he's softening it just to give that little bit of pastoral context. And I think the reason why he's softening it, he's being very pastoral with it, is because this is a hard thing to do. At face value, you think, yeah, that's not that big a deal. But it actually is not that common that we would truly experience empathy, sense and experience what others are experiencing. Now, with this verse, most of us jump to thinking that it only applies to our Christian relationships. At least that's how I've always thought of it. But remember, we were just talking in verse 14 about those who persecute us. And that could be a Christian or a non-Christian. So in the context of this passage, there is nothing that leads us to assume that this verse is only talking about non-Christians. To the contrary, Paul is bringing up how this applies to both Christians and non-Christians. So rejoice, which just means, you know, be happy, be glad with those who are glad or happy. And weep means to lament or grieve with those who are lamenting. But the word weep actually brings an emphasis on the noise from weeping. So it's talking about the wailing, like a deep anguish inside a heart that comes out through the voice. That's what weeping is. And you know who our example of experiencing empathy with all people is? It's Jesus. He really is just an amazing example in this way. Specifically, I thought of the story where Jesus was going to go visit his friends, the people that he loved, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And he's going to visit them, and by the time he gets there, Lazarus had already died. So he shows up, and he sees Mary, and Mary is weeping. Mary is experiencing what we're talking about here. But then notice what happens in John chapter 11, starting at verse 33. When Jesus saw her weeping, that's speaking about Mary, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, where have you laid him, Lazarus? They said to him, Lord, come and see. And then here's this famous verse, because it's just two words. Jesus wept. You know what's amazing about that to me? Jesus knew he was about to resurrect Lazarus. He knew that what was about to come was joy. And he was going to rejoice with those who rejoice. And knowing that was about to come, he still took the time to experience what Mary was experiencing. See, Jesus didn't skip over empathy. He experienced empathy. So I think about us and in your workplace, you should be the one who celebrates that person getting the promotion. You should be the one commending a coworker for work that they did that benefited the company in a big way. And before you jump to praying for that promotion for yourself, rejoice with those who rejoice. That's the kind of people we should be as Christians. And in the same way, in your workplace, when someone experiences loss, you should be the first person to care for that person. Even if you aren't super close, we've all experienced loss in one way or another. You know how to care for them. Just do the things you wanted someone to do for you when you experience loss. And Christians should be known as those who can be near enough to people to weep with those who weep. You know, I just find it so interesting that evangelical Christians are so well-versed on what is right and what is wrong, on what is just and what is unjust. And yet when it comes to empathy, it's like a muscle that has atrophied because we hardly ever use it. This should not be that way. The Christian response to a broken world is to experience empathy with all people. Then this, point three, we are to seek unity and peace where possible. That sounds good to me. Seeking unity and peace where possible. Verse 16 says this: live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Never be wise in your own sight. All right, let me just break that verse down for you. First, live in harmony. To live in harmony means that we would be of a common mind. And yes, obviously, we want that inside the church. And we actually want to agree on things. We want to have the same beliefs in church. We're seeking that kind of unity. But in the world, we might not be seeking the unity of agreeing on everything, but we should still be a light that brings a common mind, that we would find common ground with people around us, regardless if they're Christian or not. But how do we do that? Well, next part, do not be haughty. So Paul's going to tell us we got to get rid of something first. Do not be haughty. That means don't be arrogant. That means don't view yourself as exalted above the rest. And this is a tricky one, because if you're arrogant, you're less likely to find out that you're arrogant, because people don't really want to tell you that, okay? So you have to start examining around yourself and seeing how people respond. Do they flock to you because they sense that you're going to bring unity, or do they run away from you when it comes to a group setting, something where you're seeking unity? So let me say it with this sentence: arrogance is destructive to unity. Arrogance is destructive to unity. Man, I've seen it. We're like in a room, and you can just sense the spirit moving, and we're united. We know where we're headed. And then someone who's arrogant walks in the room, and just like, boom, like everything changes, because now it's about that person instead of the unity that we were finding in the room. Arrogance is destructive to unity. But then he goes on and he says, but associate with the lowly. That means to be preoccupied with lowly, humble pursuits. So that means fill your calendar with serving others. That means spend your day thinking about other people. And it means rejecting social constructs that make you think some people just aren't worthy of your time. That's what it means to associate with the lowly. So if arrogance is destructive to unity, here's what I know: humility is the building block of unity. So if we get rid of arrogance, how do we start building the unity? It's humility. Associate with lowly pursuits, all the things you know. Take that lower position before God and others and let the actions that flow from it come out, that you would serve them. Think about them as more significantly than yourself. Then he finishes with the phrase, never be wise in your own sight. Stop thinking that your perspective is always the right one. That's a bad play. Don't always assume that the way that you think is right. Because here's the thing, even if you have great discernment, you don't always have the right vantage point to have the right perspective. Even if you're very, very good at assessing facts and saying, this is the right perspective, don't be wise in your own sight by isolating yourself to think that only your perspective can be right. You're isolating that perspective, and isolated perspectives are the breeding ground for arrogance. So there you see that loop that can happen. If you isolate your perspective thinking, I'm the one who's right, then you can destroy unity. But if you're ready to build unity like we're supposed to, seek unity and peace where possible, then we are to associate with the lowly. And God wants this for his church. Of course he wants it for his church. But as the ambassadors that we are for his kingdom in this world, we should bring that unity into other areas besides the church. So in the circle of your friends outside of the church, do you bring a presence that naturally brings unity? Meaning when you're in a conflict or an argument, are you able to bring a positive unifying influence to your friends by being the person who doesn't act arrogantly, but instead chooses the path of humility? Because humility is the building block of unity. Continuing in verse 17. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. Pretty straightforward, right? Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. Okay, that's straightforward. But here, listen up. I love this verse because, and really, I love it because of that phrase, give thought to. That's what really stands out to me in this verse. And I know this is for someone today because this was for me this week. So listen up, listen to God's word. When you repay evil for evil, you are acting foolishly and you're responding foolishly. And foolish reactions, they tend to happen pretty fast, I will say, by experience. Someone hurt me and I immediately start thinking about how can I hurt them back. But in order to do what's honorable, and this verse says what's honorable in the sight of all, meaning it's just so obvious to everyone that that was the right thing to do. That was the good thing to do. In order to do that, you have to give thought to it. And here's the thing, that takes time. You can't just do that right away. And repaying evil with evil is normally a quick response. Honoring is a slow response. So I just believe that this is how some of you are going to get to victory over some of your shortcomings. Here, let me say it in this sentence. When you're hurt by someone, slow things down to give thought to your response. I know that some of you, in order to get to the victory and not repaying evil for evil, all you got to do is just slow things down. Right? Be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. James 1:19, right? Just slow things down. Because with some of you, I wish I could get the you of today to talk to the you of yesterday. And if you today could counsel the you of yesterday, we would be in a much better place today. So I know for some of you, the path towards victory in this area, all you got to do is just slow things down, because once you have time, then the work can start happening, and you can give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. Verse 18, love this verse, says, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Very popular verse, very practical verse. Let's break it down. It says, if possible, so that means not always doable. So far as it depends on you, that means not all of it is on you. But live peaceably with all. To live peaceably with all just means stop fighting, that you wouldn't be quarrelsome, that you're not picking fights all the time. The heart behind this is this: I'm going to do what I can to not be in conflict with others. I'm going to do what I can to not be in conflict with others. But here's the thing, that's not always possible. Because Jesus even told us in John chapter 15, verse 18 and 19, it says this: if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. The world hates the one we follow. And if you follow Jesus Christ, there's never going to be that full sense of like, we can just always find peace and always agree. That's not possible, because the gospel to them is foolishness and it's offensive. So I would say a reality check is, if you feel like the world can just embrace you as its own, as it says here in this passage, that there's no conflict of belief between you and the world, that's not a good sign. That's not a good sign, because if you follow Jesus Christ, there are pieces and parts of following Jesus that are in direct conflict with the world. And the world's going to hate you for it. And if it's between brothers and sisters, you're still going to do what you can to not be in conflict with others. And for those situations where resolution just isn't possible, what's important is that you are confident that you have done what you can, and that you've owned as much as you can. And the rest you're leaving in God's hands, but you're always expectant and ready to stop the conflict if God opens that door. That's the heart of a Christian who's responding to a broken world. And then finally this, point four, we are to trust God to bring justice. Trust God to bring justice. Verse 19. Beloved, okay, so Paul's pulling us in here. He's saying, brothers, sisters, beloved, I love you guys. I want you to hear the truth. Here it is. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. When Paul says that phrase, says the Lord, that is like an exclamation point. He is being very, very clear that this isn't just his idea. This comes straight from what God has said. He's putting that punctuation mark on it, and I can do the same and tell you, look, this isn't Eddie saying this to you. This isn't any other leader in the church telling me to say this. This is God's word saying that vengeance belongs to God alone. That's what he says. You're not supposed to avenge yourself. And I get it. Look, I know you desire justice. I do too. And I would say some people, they don't just want justice. They burn for justice. As soon as they see something that's unjust, that's like, that is pushing their button. But God is saying that it's not your job to avenge yourself. That means you shouldn't be taking matters into your own hands. Leave it to the wrath of God, because here's the thing. God clearly says that vengeance is something that only he can be trusted with. Only God can be trusted with vengeance. And when we get to the end of the ages, when all this stuff is just, it's all said and done, you know what's going to be said about God? Revelation 19, 2. His judgments are true and just. Every single decision that God made in regard to justice and his judgment, they'll be true and they'll be just. He's the only one who should be trusted with bringing vengeance. So only when you really trust God to bring justice can you get to the place where you can let go of trying to find justice on your own. So if I'm not supposed to avenge myself, then what do I do with my enemies? Check this, verse 20. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. To give them food or water is just a way of saying that you should meet a need of your enemy, if you can. Christians should be wildly kind, generous people. Why? Because God's been good to us. God's been so good to us. And I know you might be going through some things, but God is good to you. And because he's been good to you, only when you think about his goodness, that's the only way we can get to the place where we're meeting the needs of our enemies, if we can, as an act of kindness. And the result, what will happen if we do these things, is that we will bring good to our enemies. That phrase, heap burning coals on his head, is an extremely difficult phrase to translate and understand. But here's what's not hard to understand, I would say, because of the context that it's in, and that is that it's a good thing. So let's interpret it a bit, because, like I said, it's very difficult to translate. So let's start with this. Is it literal? Are we saying that if we feed and give water to our enemies, that then by so doing that, we are walking over with some hot rocks to burn their heads? Like, no, right? So obviously not literal. So what that means is it's an idiom. And an idiom is something that you say that represents something else. And every culture has this. This is completely normal. Let me give you an American idiom, all right? Now imagine I go to the theater and I see my friend backstage who's going to be in the play, and I say, hope you have a great show. Then I say what? Break a leg. Break a leg is not literal, okay? It's an idiom. It means do a great job. Now, I don't know where that phrase came from, and I'm sure I could have Googled it, but I don't really care. I understand it. It just means do a great job. Now imagine you're a historian hundreds of years later, and all you have is a transcript of my conversation back with my friend, and you see that Eddie said, have a great show, break a leg, and you're like, well, what? What could that guy possibly be saying? And even if you didn't understand the American idiom of break a leg, you could still draw the conclusion that it was a good thing. Why? Because of the context. The context is, have a great show, break a leg. We can do the exact same thing in this verse. Meet your enemy's needs as an extreme act of kindness, and that will result in you doing good towards them. So whatever that idiom meant, we know that it was something good. Then this final verse, verse 21, says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Don't be defeated by evil. Don't give up. And you don't have to just sit down and take it and receive all the evil in the world. You can defeat evil, but not with evil. You can defeat evil with good. You can defeat evil with good. Now, before I close, let me just clarify that Paul is about to talk about how we're subject to our governing authorities in chapter 13 in the first part of it. So please don't misapply this message to a situation where someone is breaking the law in the way that they're treating you, and now you think that you're not to report them to the authorities. That's not at all what I'm saying, and that's not at all what Paul's saying. Paul would say the opposite. He would say, subject yourself to the governing authorities, and you have to report unlawful behavior to them immediately. But if you've already done that, or if this enemy of yours isn't breaking the law in the way that they're treating you, then make sure you're doing what Romans 12, 14 through 21 has taught us to do today. Defeat evil with good. So I ask you, what are the ways you are responding to this broken world? Do you speak blessing over evil? Do you have a strong ability to empathize with the joy and pain of others? Are you known as someone who brings unity and peace to whatever situation they're in? And are you trusting God to bring justice instead of taking matters into your own hands? Look, I know that there are thousands of circumstances in the lives of the people listening to me right now. I don't see them, I don't know them, but I know that God sees them. And God sees you, and He knows what you're up against. And yet He's still calling you to respond in this way to the broken world that you live in. So I'm asking you, is there something that God has taught you today that you know your situation, you know that person that we're talking about, and God's word would say that the way you're responding isn't what He wants? Well, today's a great day because you can change that response. You can say yes to the Lord, and by His grace, here we are, and here we are looking at His word. So I know the Holy Spirit's already done the work. If He's already spoken and you know the situation we're talking about, you know He's saying, here, this is what I want. You know this is what I want. I just need you to say yes. If that's you, I'm going to ask you to do something very simple. Just wherever you're at, watching online, would you just raise your hand for a second? I know that might be weird if there's some people around you or if you're out in public. Hey, it's okay to be a little weird today. Just respond to the Lord and raise your hand and say, God, I'm going to change the way I'm responding in that situation. I know my hand's up. God's spoken to me this week. Let me pray for all of you who've raised your hand. Father, thank you. Thank you for Romans 12. Thank you for guiding us in how to respond to this broken world around us. It just feels like things are changing so fast. Even just 100 years ago, people used to view Christians as the ones who were pursuing morality or trying to do good things. And now in our culture, we're viewed as intolerant and unloving. That is such a big change. So Lord, now more than ever, we need to respond to this world that is broken the way you say we should respond. Would you help us, God, not just to not do the wrong thing. We want to do the right thing, the thing you want us to do. But we need your help, God. For every person who's raised their hand, I know you see them. I know you know them. You know exactly what's going on. You know the name that came to their mind. You know the situation that came to their mind. Holy Spirit, would you comfort right now? Comfort and give strength to be able to do the things that you're calling us to do as Christians in this broken world. But Lord, how we long for the day when you're coming back. For this that we're feeling isn't forever. This isn't forever. There's a day where it's going to be over. For King Jesus is coming back. Come quickly, Lord, we say even now. How we long for the day where all will look to you and we will join that crowd that says that your judgments were true and they were just. There was not one thing that you did, God, that was wrong. There was not one thing that you did that was unjust. You are perfectly just, and you will rule, and you will reign. So God, help us to build our life upon your love, because you're the one who loved us first. Help us to be the people who are growing in faith and who are growing in love for this broken world, just like you love them, God. You love them so much that you would send Jesus to die for them. And so now we live in the freedom because of the work that you've done. And so we want to respond to you, God, and worship you. We lift our hands to you. We lift our voice to you because we declare that we will build our life upon the things that you have said, upon the things that you have done, for you're the only one worthy of that response. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's worship him. not be shaken because we will trust in him. Hey, thanks for joining us today. We're so glad that you were able to be here. As we finish up today, we just want you to hear these words. You are loved.